Right.
I want to say today, say this morning, that I want to worship His holy name. Thank you, Lord, from where you brought me.
Amen.
In spite of everything I've done to mess it up, I want to praise His name from where He brought me. Thank you, Lord, for your revelation of your grace and who you are. I praise your name for that. One thing I want to say is on my heart when I was over there before I get into my message. I want to say something about the fivefold ministry. Most people have heard it. It had nothing to do with my message today. It's apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. The Bible is very clear on the purpose of the fivefold ministry. The purpose of the fivefold ministry is to equip the saints and feed the flock. Raise your hand here if you're a saint. And you're also the flock. That's who we are, as redeemed Christians, birthed into the family of Christ, and the Spirit of Christ lives inside us. So whatever I am, I told you before, I don't know what I am, but evidently I'm probably fall under one of those five there. My job, Kim's job, Spencer's job, anybody's job that stands up here, today is the day of salvation. If you're here today and you're lost, today is the day for you and your salvation. Man. But my job is to stand up here and to feed the flock and equip the saints. Where when we are all equipped, the synergy of us equipped together, going out into the world from Monday to Saturday, that is what the Great Commission is. It's not for me to stand up here and badger y'all about all these things that we've been badgered about our whole life in different churches. Our job is to lift you up. So when we go into work, when we go into the grocery store, wherever we go, people say, man, look at Richard. Man, he loves people. Man, he loves his neighbor. He loves God. That is the job of me standing up here today, is to equip the saints and feed the flock so we, the church, can go out into the world and bring the true message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is His unconditional love and His grace toward us in spite of our performance. Man, amen. What an awesome story to go tell you, huh?
Amen.
All right, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we come to you today in the name of Jesus Christ, and we thank you, Lord, for who you are, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for being love. That's who you are. That's not one of your attributes, Lord. That's who you are. You are love, and we thank you for that. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for sending your Son down here, down on the cross, in our place, Lord. And I just pray now, Lord, that everybody here can lay down their flesh and their fleshly way of thinking and put on their spiritual ears, Lord. Because the only way that they will be equipped today is if you do it in the Spirit. Ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
The title of my message today is The Nature of God. And when I started studying and doing this message, you can go online and just do a Google search of the nature of God. And it will blow you away what comes up. I'm just here to tell you. You know, so what I'm going to talk about today is, you know, God is merciful, God is justice, God is patient, God has wrath. I'm just telling some things that I read on the internet. And we, as a New Testament church, we're under the new covenant.
Yep.
So when you hear any preacher, any teacher, any evangelist, anybody talk about God's wrath, they're going back to the old covenant. The Bible says it's not here today, but I preached on it and said something about it in one of my other messages. In the book of Isaiah, God makes a covenant. And he's actually, it's in the book of Isaiah, but he's talking about Noah and the flood. He says, just as I have promised Noah that I would never flood the earth again with water, I promise you that I will never be angry with you again. How about that? And then he says something about the mountains will pass away before my covenant with you passes away. God is not angry with us. God is not showing any wrath toward us. And we're going to get into some scripture here today. And I'm going to prove this. You let the word speak for itself when we get into it. And I'm going to read some scripture in Hebrew. It's kind of down my list a little bit. But understand this. The Bible says that Jesus came. I'm not going to read that today. Come to destroy the works of the devil. It also says that he came to do away with sin. That's why Jesus' purpose to come to this earth in the book of Hebrews, I'm going to read it in a second, is to do away with sin. So if Jesus came down to this earth to do away with sin, and he left this earth, and he did not do away with sin, Jesus was a failure. Think on that. And we walk around, and we still think somehow that our sin is in our life. But what I'm going to talk about today in the nature of God is God's love. It's not one of his attributes, like I said. It is who he is. God is love. That's what he is. That's how he sees us. He sees us in love. And the Bible says in the book of Galatians, chapter 5, this is just a scripture here that I threw in. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith. Faith. And this was a big issue here in Paul's age. Should we be circumcised? Should we not be circumcised? And it was a very big deal to the Jewish people. And Paul just come along. And basically, when I hear circumcision in the Bible, it's just a law. It's just doing rituals in order to obtain favor with God. Whether it's circumcision, whether it's going to church on Sundays, whether it's reading only the King James Bible. You know, you don't read the same Bible I read. Any type of religious ritual that you think is going to get you favor with God is just not going to work. Circumcision or uncircumcision. The only thing that counts is faith, experiencing itself through love. The King James Bible says, faith worketh through love. The only thing that we have with God, with our relationship, is faith. Because your righteousness is a filthy rags. So what's that make your good works? Your good works. Your bad works. Your good works are filthy rags, so your bad works. I can't even imagine what they would be. Right? So faith worketh through love. And all we have is faith for God. And the only way we're going to understand this is knowing how God intends to deal with us in love. So I'm going to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. This is from the NIV, and the King James words are a little different, but it says that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ. The Bible in the story of the Christmas, you hear about this story all the time, when it says peace on earth, what that's talking about, peace on earth and goodwill toward men. Is there peace on earth? There's not peace on earth. What that means is, it's talking about this right here. Jesus came to this earth to bring peace between you and God. There's no longer any conflict once you step over into faith between you and God. He has reconciled us to himself through Christ. Not counting people's sins against them. The King James Bible says not imputing their sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. God is not counting your sins against you anymore. He counted your sins against Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That is a great exchange. Jesus got what I deserved. I get what Jesus deserved. And the confusion comes in on this through religious teaching is taught that we step over into the family of faith and over into Christ by faith and faith alone. That's the only, when you hear this taught over and over and over again, you can't get to heaven by your good works, you can't get to heaven by your good works. You can't get anything from God by your good works because you have no good works. The only good works you have are him working through you. And so many teachings birth you into the family of Christ through faith alone, then they take you right back to the law and put you under rituals, and you do these things to gain favor with God or gain acceptance with God. But the fact is the only hope that we have with God is in Christ Jesus, and our faith placed solely in Him. And the way you will never be productive in the kingdom of God until you understand that God is no longer imputing your sins against you. Because I told Elaine this, it came out of the office this week. I read this when I was studying for this message. One thing legalism never says is good job.
That's right.
Legalism never tells you good job. Yeah. Never. You are doomed.
That's true.
All right. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26 is the scripture that I kind of jumped ahead of myself, but I'm going to let the Spirit lead me, and I might get out of whack again in a minute. Otherwise, Christ would have to suffer many times since the creation of the world. And there's a bunch of meat here you can talk about, because some people believe that you have to keep entering back in to be forgiven. And, you know, there's total denominations out there that believe if you have one unconfessed sin that you hadn't went to God, you're going to go to hell. You're not entering back in over and over again. The burden of our salvation is not on us. And you run that, every doctrine you hear, you run that through that filter. If anything puts the burden on you, it's a false teaching, because the burden was on Jesus Christ. And He came here and gave it all to us as a free gift. The burden of our salvation was on Jesus. And all he wants us to do is believe Him. How easy is that? How easy is that? But He had appeared once for all, that the culmination of the ages, to do away with sin by the sacrifice of Himself. Did Jesus do away with our sin?
Yes.
If Jesus done away with our sin, don't you go and bring them back up and walk in them and toil in them every day. Lord, I done this, you know, and I don't want to get over on this, but it is a transforming of your mind over into understanding that I am righteous, I am holy, I am a son of God. Y'all notice when I pray, I always pray to my Father in heaven. Because if y'all notice, when Jesus was hanging on the cross, when all our sin was on Him and God had forsaken Him, how did He refer to His daddy at that time? He said, "My God, my God." That's because at that time, He had moved over into Him was His God. After the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, I refer to Him as Abba Father, my Father in heaven. I'm over here in sonship. I don't pray to God. I pray to my Father,
Amen.
The one who loves me, the one who is love, who wants me to do well. That's who I pray for. But Jesus came to do away with sin. And trust me, guys, He accomplished what He came for. He accomplished what He came for. And here's something that I want to get to here in this message of God love and God being love. And He is love. That's all He is. I had in my head for so many years of this wrong image of God, that God was wrath. And God, y'all hear me say this, God's got a lightning bolt in one hand and a sledgehammer in the other hand, and He's just waiting on you to get out of line. Well, I had that flat tire last week. I guess I wouldn't live in that, you know. I ain't tithed my money in 3 weeks, but, you know, my water heater went out. God's going to get it somehow. I mean, who's heard these teachings and these things? But I'm going to prove right here in these scriptures that it was never God's intention to deal with us through anything but love and grace. God's intention from the very beginning of time was to deal with us in love and in grace. And if you study out the law, they asked for it. Remember? They wanted it. They wanted the law. But this right here is something that I'm going to be honest with you guys. I don't completely understand what I'm about to tell you. But I can tell you this. That you have to make your theology match up with the Word of God. That's all you can do. You hear, there's this guy, I listen to his commentary all the time, and he says, people don't let the Word get in the way of their theology. But the scripture I'm going to read right here, just meditate on what this says here. In Romans chapter 5, now I've heard me talk about this maybe before. This is a deep thought here. To be sure, sin was in the world before the law was given. But sin is not, here's the word again, imputed. In the King James Bible, it's the same verbiage here in this. But sin is not charged to the account of anyone's account where there was no law.
Right.
So you have to ask then, from Adam and Eve, all the way to the time of the law, what were they living under? They were living under grace. They were not living under the lightning bolt in one hand and a sledgehammer in the other hand. They were living under grace. You have to make your theology match this here. Sin was in the world, right? Sin was in the world because, and I think the King James even says death was in the world too. Somehow it's worded that way. But sin was there. Death was there. But God wouldn't hold people's sins against them. He wouldn't count their sins onto them. Isn't that awesome news?
Amen.
God never intended for us to live under that. God intends on us to live under love. How awesome is that? Let's look at this right here. In the book of Genesis here. Here is the first murderer. Here's another thing, guys. When y'all go out and hear people say, this society is going downhill. They scumbags, they're ungodly, unholy. Keep in mind that the human race, the very first person ever born on this earth, killed his brother. We're not going downhill from there. That's a side note. Think about that.
That's good.
Everybody knows this story, but let's look here how God deals with it. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is your brother Abel? I don't know, he replied. Am I my brother's keeper? The Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you. You will be restless wanderers of the earth. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is more than I can bear. Today you are driving me from the land, and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. But here's God right here. But the Lord said to him, not so. Anyone who kills Cain will suffer vengeance seven times over. Then the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one would find who found him would kill him. All right? Now, let's go over to the book of Numbers. It's the book of Numbers 15, 32 through 36. This is right after the law had been given. Here comes the law down now. They wanted it, now they got it. While the Israelites were in the wilderness, a man was found gathering wood on the Sabbath day. Uh-oh, now we've got law. The law's here, and he's just out picking up wood on the Sabbath day. Keep in mind now, Cain was under grace. Now we're under law. Cain murdered his brother. And God said, I'm going to put a mark on you. Nobody will mess with you. Now let's see what happens over here now that they've moved under law. While the Israelites were in the wilderness, a man was found gathering wood on the Sabbath day. Those who found him gathering wood brought him to Moses and Aaron and the whole assembly. And they kept him in custody because it was not clear what should be done of him. Then the Lord said to Moses, the man must die. The whole assembly must stone him outside the camp. So the assembly took him outside the camp and stoned him to death, as the Lord commanded Moses. So we have a good example here of the difference of you being under grace and you being under law.
Yep.
God's not stoning you. God's going to do everything he can to protect his children. And today, like I was saying about the fivefold ministry, today I would love for one person to leave here with a changed mind about God's love and God's grace. Then we can go out and we can make a difference in the world. God is love. God never intended for us to be under wrath. Never, ever, never, never intended that. Okay, I told Dwayne that I was doing some studying last night, and I got some more stuff that's not going to be on the PowerPoint, then I'll get back to the PowerPoint in a minute. 1 John 4:19 says this, we love because he first loved us. That's why we love. And y'all hear us talk about this all the time at this church. I call it spiritual dyslexia. Not a lot of times we get things, not just get them wrong, we get them backwards. It's one thing to be wrong, but from what I know about dyslexia, it sees it backwards. I mean, we totally not just mess up our theology, but we see things backwards. So this is some scripture here that we quote a lot at this church, and you hear us talk about it. But let's look at this. I'm gonna read it out of my Bible, and it's not going to be up here. But it's where they came to Jesus and asked him. Remember here that we love because he first loved us. That's why we love. You can't love when you're under a law to love. Can't do it. When you get the revelation of God's love, anybody here that has got this revelation and experience in their life will amen and shout on this one. Mm-hmm. When you experience God's love for you and truly just get a glimpse of how much he loves you, how much easier was it to you love your neighbor? Right. And man, these people, you know, that you normally wouldn't love, you're like, man, I love you. I don't care what you've done. I've got my own issues. I love you because I've experienced God's love in my life.
That's right.
I love because God loved me.
Yep.
Remember, God don't love you because you're lovely. He loves you because he's love. He is love. And when we experience God's love, it empowers us to love others and love thy God with all thy heart. That's what I'm going to read right here. This is an interesting thing to think about right here. Matthew chapter 22:36-39. And it says, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? They're asking Jesus, what is the greatest commandment in the law? What is the purpose of the law? The purpose of the law is to show you that you need Jesus. That's the whole purpose. I tell y'all this all the time, that there's two ways to answer the question, why did God give the law? One answer is to show us how to live. The other answer is to show us that you can't live that way. Which way will you answer? God gave me the rules and the regulations to show me I couldn't do it. There's your two answers. So here they are. They're talking about the law. They're asking Jesus. And are they under law here? They sure are. And they ask Jesus, Master, this is verse 30. What is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus said unto them, Thou shalt love thy Lord with all thy heart. And with thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and the great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Okay. So Jesus gave them a law. Y'all go do it. How does that work out for y'all? The way Jesus understood the purpose of the law and how the law works. Jesus knows that the only way that you will love thy God with all thy heart and love thy neighbor as thyself is if you understand 1 John 4:19, which says, we love because he first loved us.
That's right.
Right? We love because he first loved us. Let me tell y'all a story God gave me this week. My wife's not in here, so it's a story about my wife. My wife, y'all saw her, she's very small, she's very petite. I'm not. My wife does not have a weight problem. I do. Sometimes. And what she does is she only drinks water. She eats no fried food. If the only thing she has to eat is fried chicken, she will pull the bread and the fried off of it. I'm like, what are you doing? She drinks juice. And here I am trying to do self-discipline. And I'm not going to eat this and I'm going to do that. But here's the thing. My wife don't like Coca-Cola. My wife doesn't like fried food. She doesn't like these cheesy, greasy things. She has changed her mind on how she feels about eating and food. And she's never on a diet, by the way. How many people do y'all know that are on a diet? Atkins, Weight Watchers. The million diets that these people get on, and what do they give you? They won't give you any rules. You need to do this, don't do this, don't do this, do this, don't do this, don't do this. And how many people, think about the people that y'all know. It is a constant struggle on eating, drinking, exercising, because they're under the law of trying to do it, and it makes it more difficult.
Right.
If I could ever change my mind to thinking the way my wife thinks about eating and about food, it's easy. She doesn't wake up and go try to do it. It's just what she does. How awesome is that? And that's the way it is with God's love. We change our mind over into knowing how much He loves us and the condition that we were in without Him. And we just love people, and you can't help it. My wife goes into a restaurant, and I know she's going to drink water. And I might get some sweet tea, and I think, man, I should be getting water. But it makes it so difficult because I have not transformed my mind over into being helpful. I just haven't. And these people who set up these laws of Weight Watchers and whatever, it's a constant battle. Yep. It's a constant battle. And that is exactly the way it works with God. If we could ever renew our mind to knowing how much God loves us because of who He is, man, we would go out into this world and to work and to wherever we go, and man, they would think, where do you go to church? What are you doing? I want a little bit of what you got. How do you do that? I don't do it. You don't do it. It's just, we just want to love one another. That's what this whole church is about. We just want to love you. And back to my original point of equipping the saints and feeding the flock. That was the reason I said that. Today, I would love for everybody to go out of here understanding how much God loves us and how He never intended to deal with us in any other way but love and grace. That's all He intended. And if we focus on His love, the love will just pour out of us. It will be effortless. I'm telling you guys. That's how it works. You won't be able to help it. In closing, I've done a whole message on this one scripture here, but I feel like reading it and making the point again. It's been a while back. And I'm sure a lot of y'all wouldn't hear when I preached this message. But when I was studying for this, God impressed it to me to share it again. So if you've heard it before, you'll get excited because it's awesome news. And if not, meditate and think on the scriptures here I'm about to read. It's in Romans chapter 5, verse 6 through 11. This is how much God loved us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Since we now have been justified by His blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through Him? For if while we were God's enemy, we were reconciled to Him through the death of His Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through His life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This is how much God loves you. In these scriptures right here, It says that we were powerless, you were ungodly, you were a sinner, and you were an enemy of Almighty God. That was your condition that you were in. Those are pretty bold words, aren't they? Mm-hmm. That is your condition that you were in without Christ. And the Bible, based off the scripture right here, when you were in that condition, enemies of God, ungodly, powerless, think about that. That's where you were. At that point in time is when Jesus came and died for you. You were powerless, ungodly, sinners, and enemies of God. And God decided in His great love that I'm going to go die for Him. I'm going to go die for Him.
Amen.
Think about that. That's when He came and died for you, when you were hopeless. That's how much He loved you. He gave Himself on the cross when you were in the worst condition that you could be. And then religion comes along and teaches us that somehow we're going to improve our conditions and receive more from God. When you were enemies, sinners, ungodly, God gave you everything He had. He gave you everything when you were in your worst condition. Yeah. How are you going to do anything to receive anything more? By you improving yourself. God wants us to step over into His grace and into His faith in Christ, and you can be set free. You can be set free today if you want it. Yeah. It's about changing your mind off of the Weight Watchers style of living for God, of trying to do it on your own, and changing your mind over into being, I'm going to be healthy. This ain't about me being on a diet and waking up every day trying to do it. And it will transform your actions. And I'm telling you, you'll be more godly on accident than you could ever have been on purpose. Because you will start loving people and loving God. And it will be the greatest revelation, I'm telling you. That's why I get so excited about this, y'all. Because it changed me. It changed me. It changed my life. And I just want to go tell, I'm going to tell it on the mountain. I'm going to tell everybody about what He's done. And His great love that He had for me. And I pray and I hope, I don't even say this all the time joking, but I'm serious. I've got my issues. I got some issues going on with me. And I don't try to hide them. And I don't try to act like I'm anything but a little bit messed up. But I hope that y'all see love in me.
Yep.
I love y'all. I love my neighbor. I love people. That's what I hope y'all see in me. Thank y'all.
Amen.